Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. Economics for finance is the subject that contributes 40% of the marks to paper 8 of CA Intermediate in group 2. Should we call it a subject? Yes, we can. It is a subject by itself. But the problem with that is, if you just say economics as one of the words that is used in this description, then as a subject, economics is much broader than this particular area that we are going to study. Should we call this a paper? Again, the problem is, this itself is not a full paper, it is only contributing to 40%. So the fact is, we cannot call it a subject also in its full form. We cannot call it a paper also in its fullest extent. But still, there is no option but to call it. So now onwards, whenever I say this subject or this paper, you have to interpret it in this way. When I'm talking about this subject, I'm not talking about the economics as a whole. That is a big ocean, and we're only going to take a small portion of it for our requirements. So the interpretation of the word economics here should not be in a broader sense. It should be to the extent it is applicable for this particular segment, which is there in the CA syllabus as prescribed by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, ICAI. Same way, whenever I say paper, you have to understand I'm not talking about the other 60 marks, which is financial management. That is also part of paper 8, but that is not what we are going to discuss in this series. So this series of lectures is going to be related to the 40% of paper 8. But still, every time I cannot call it as 40% of paper 8, 40% of paper 8. So I'm going to simply refer it to as this paper. So the essence of this is, whenever I say this subject, we need to understand, I'm talking about not the entire economics, but economics for finance. Whenever I'm talking about this paper, then also I'm referring to the same thing, but not to the entire paper. So these words will be used synonymously. They should not be understood or interpreted in their real sense, because for the simple reason, this is neither the entire subject of economics that we are studying here, nor it is the entire paper 8 that we are going to study here. It's only a part of it. So naturally, we need to draw our boundaries. We should understand what is the scope of learning as far as this paper or subject is concerned. Already I used those words, which means this particular segment of subject of economics, this particular segment of the paper of paper 8. Every time I'm not going to use that explanation. So this paper, that is economics for finance, has its scope derived from mostly macroeconomics. And what was the requirement, first of all, for an accountant or a accounting student or a finance student to learn economics? How come economics is going to be useful for a chartered accountant? What is the requirement of this subject to be introduced in the syllabus at all? Other things we can understand. Oh, accounting, definitely yes. Taxation, auditing, laws, different types of subjects like cost accounting or management accounting, financial management, we can understand. Those are all generally the basic things that any finance and accounting student should learn. But why economics? What is the need of economics to be introduced in this course and syllabus? Why? Because the role of the chartered accountant has been changing. Traditionally, the role of a chartered accountant was more restricted to traditional areas like accounting, taxation, attest functions, and auditing. So one way we can say the chartered accountant's role in earlier decades was mostly functional in nature, or it is regulatory. These are the two things broadly the chartered accountants will have more exposure to all these years. And even now it is true also that functional and regulatory works across the various sectors are being dealt with by chartered accountants. But are they the only two things? The modern chartered accountant, the future chartered accountant should know, with the dynamic business environment that is changing very rapidly? The answer is no. Definitely the course had to cope up with the various changes in the role of a chartered accountant, or simply speaking a finance professional in any industry or an organization or even in practice. That's what happened over a period of time, not in one day. So what has changed substantially now is the role of chartered accountant has changed and shifted towards strategic decision making related situations. And not only that, entrepreneurial roles. So more than regulatory, now value adding activities are also equally and in fact more important in the current scenario when compared with the traditional functional and regulatory roles that finance professionals use it to fulfill. So naturally the scope of the chartered accountant has to go beyond the traditional financial reporting. So in a simple manner we can say functional and regulatory roles of chartered accountants are there, even now there. We are not saying that they have gone, but they are going to be mostly changed slowly or drastically. Already they have undergone a lot of changes, and in future naturally they will undergo many changes, wherein from this functional or regulatory nature of work, one word definitely will be expected from the finance professionals, that is value addition. Simply, some company will prepare the financial statements. Of course, some of the accountants, including chartered accountants, might be helpful in that, as employees of that company in the finance department might have prepared them. So that is part of the financial reporting function that people used to do. And now we are doing. And after the financials are prepared, another finance professional, another chartered accountant comes and audits it. And then he attests the financial statements, saying that they're showing the true and fair view of the state of affairs of the organization. So that function chartered accountants are fulfilling. Same way, lot of regulatory things like tax audit, GST audit, those are being undertaken by chartered accountants. Those are there. They may not go away quickly, but at the same time, are they only the things that are going to be there forever in the same way? Answer is no. The profession is changing more towards value addition than just attestation. Value addition comes in many respects. Some of the aspects we can think about, particularly from within the organization, or even as a consultant outside the organization also. This may come from different segments. It can be in the form of assisting the management through management accounting, which helps in the strategic decision making of the management. It comes in the form of financial management. We can call it strategic financial management, whatever the name we give. So simply speaking, for understanding purposes, costing, financial management, strategic management, EIS, economics for finance. These are all the areas which are also equally important, and they keep on becoming more and more important in the coming future also. That does not mean accounting will go. That does not mean auditing and taxation will become redundant or outdated. They will remain. That is why we have those papers also. But they are not enough. We need more than that. That is why this subject, like economics for finance, also has been introduced in this course, so that the finance professional can understand what is an economy. Just to simplify, if as a chartered accountant or as a finance professional, if you open a business newspaper, something like Economic Times or Financial Express, whatever, can you read it completely and understand it? Nobody can 100% understand, except that editor maybe. But at least, are you able to follow what is happening? If we cannot follow that, then definitely our value addition role will get affected badly. Every finance professional should be able to understand economy, should be able to understand what is happening around. It is not just about sitting in front of our desk, filing some tax returns, doing some accounting in some softwares. Yes, that is also required. But that is not just the job that is expected of us. Lot more is expected of from the finance professionals, in what way they value, they add value to the organization, either as an employee or as a consultant to the organizations. So directly by understanding economics, are we going to add any value? No, we cannot exactly match them. Lot of times it so happens that we cannot relate the subjects, what we learn, to what its usefulness is all about. I will share some of the personal experiences. For example, in 10th standard, 8th standard, school days at least, you all would have studied history. Some history, definitely, yes. Indian history, world history, something we would have studied. Why we studied? Mostly with an objective of getting some marks in that exam. That's all. Nothing much more interesting than obtaining certain marks in that exam. Most of the people will do that. Imagine somebody has done that and just forgotten about everything that has been learned, understood and wanted in the examinations. Maybe he got 98 marks, 100 marks also in that paper. It doesn't matter. But is it going to be useful in life? How is it going to be useful? We can't understand actually where is it going to be useful. We cannot map that always. A plus B whole square we learned in school days. Tell me one instance till now where you used it in real life. Maybe we cannot. Or maybe we are not in a position to understand. Maybe the inventions that are happening now and the kind of things that we are using like mobile phones while doing some programming, somewhere in that writing of the program, A plus B whole square would have been used, it might have been used. You don't know that, I don't know that. That does not mean A plus B whole square is useless. It has its own use somewhere. Just because we don't know where is that, we should not jump to a conclusion that it was all useless learning. Everything that we learn as part of a defined syllabus, what we have chosen or what has been given to us, will have some purpose. So in my example, I'm sharing with you, the world history that I have read, at least I know some names. And suddenly if I use those names when I was working abroad, I met different nationalities. I met Americans, Britishers, Arabs, Chinese, Japanese, different nationalities. In different meetings, we talk to them. They might be our clients. And sometimes they may be colleagues. A lot of discussions happen. While doing so, if I just take some informal discussion, maybe over a coffee with them, about their country, I could see the a kind of glow in their eyes. That does not mean I'm a historian, I know things about all the countries. No, not like that. Just a mention of the name. Some mention of one writer. Oh, that writer is a great writer, I read somewhere. That writer could be from their country and they might be proud of that guy. And their eyes will glow. It's not going to really add anything to us, maybe professionally, directly. But is it going to help us indirectly or not? Definitely yes. So the point to note here is, the work of the finance professional, be it even in the field of auditing, be it even in the field of accounting or even taxation or consulting or the new areas, what we are looking at, it's not just about desk work. It's about people. It's about communication also with the other people. Interpersonal communication is one of the important things. And people attend interpersonal communication. I don't understand. Interpersonal communication can happen only if you know at least something about other person's interests. Simple, nothing else. If other person has an interest in movies, you should know at least something about movies. Something, not like you are an expert. If other person is interested about cricket, at least you should know something about. If other person talks about Kohli, you say, who is that guy? Gone. Whatever the greatest possible language you have, that other interpersonal communication will not happen much. That kind of rapport cannot be built between human beings without talking to others about their interests. So I'm not telling that we should become Google and we should know everything. No, I'm not telling that. I'm only just trying to make a point here. Even what we learned earlier, which we thought they are of no use, they will be useful at some point in life. The people who have designed the syllabus, they know that. We, at that time, thought it is just a paper. Some marks are coming from that. I am happy with that. My point is, that should not be the attitude. That should not be the idea. Of course, we will get marks. Ultimately, our objective is definitely to obtain the best marks out of any paper. No doubt in that. But is that the only objective? That is the major differentiation we have to take about any subject, for that matter, even life. For anybody, earning money is very important. No doubt about it. That is the fuel for the journey in this society. But does it mean it is the only purpose of life, earning money? Definitely not. Same way, marks are very important. Without them, we cannot get better scores. Without them, we cannot move forward. Without them, we cannot get success in the examinations that we are trying to write and qualify. So they are important. But once again, if we approach any subject for that matter, only with an objective, only with the idea of marks, M-A-R-K-S marks, that may not be the correct approach. So definitely, we need to understand there are so many advantages of learning certain subjects like that. This subject gives us an advantage in very different sense. Understanding economics is not just about talking to some people about big words. It is also about understanding the business. It is also about understanding the market dynamics. It is also about understanding or even sometimes having the ability to predict or having the ability to forecast the trends. And we are not like blessed with some supernatural powers that we can forecast things. We cannot. But with the knowledge related to the economics and understanding of what is happening, at least to start with, then over a period of time with experience, this subject will be very helpful in career, whether it is practice as a consultant or even as an employee of many types of organizations. Just imagine, just for general understanding purposes, if some client discussion is happening and the client suddenly asks, sir, what is this repo rate daily I am seeing in this newspaper? People are telling that is increased repo rate, decreased. What nonsense is that? You are a chartered accountant. What can you please tell me? Like that, if some client asks, there are two choices for us. We can say, Google it, boss. Why are you asking me? You can do that. Actually, this is not a big deal. Anybody can Google it and understand. Yes, that is one option. But definitely, better than that would be what? You already knowing it. And you having an understanding about it and trying to explain to the other person in simpler terms, not in the complicated terms. When can you explain something in the simpler terms? When you understand it. Similarly, Einstein had a very famous quotation. It is very easy. And in fact, mostly the fools will make the things complicated. But it takes a bit of courage to go the other side. Means to make it simpler, you need knowledge. To make it complicated, it is any idiot can do that. Any intelligent idiot can do that. That's what Einstein said. That's not a big deal, actually. Any intelligent idiot can make the things complex. But a touch of genius and courage is required to go other way, means to make it simpler. We are not geniuses and all, but at least in the world where we live and communicate with people, are we not expected to know these things? Actually, every citizen actually is expected to know these things. But definitely, we cannot expect that. Because literacy itself is not 100%. How can we expect financial literacy? Maybe in India, we can say hardly 2 to 3% of the people are financially literate. Economic literacy definitely will be less than 1%. For sure. But the point is, are we in that 1 or 2% or are we in that 98%, 99% is our choice. Chartered accountants are supposed to be in that 1% because we are at least expected to be knowing these things and we have to know them. Not just for our 40 marks. 40 marks anyway we'll get and we'll become chartered accountants only with that 40 marks. Also added to our kitty. But even later, we are supposed to know various aspects related to the economy as a whole. That is the reason why emphasis has been given on economics, particularly on macroeconomics at this level of CA intermediate. Now, what has caused all these kind of changes in our profession and requirements? So many things are there, but just to look at some of the factors. Of course, the business complexities are all increasing. Economies are all becoming borderless. We can almost say that the entire world has become a global village, as we often hear it. And there is a giant leap in e-commerce. Simple example of that is recently, Jeff Bezos, Amazon's boss, is the richest man of the world. How could he become? Because e-commerce is on the top. Earlier, maybe 10 years back, or maybe 15 years back also, Bill Gates was the richest man of the world, wealthiest man, let us say. How? Because at that time, software industry was on the top. Now Bill Gates has become number two, if I'm right. And Jeff Bezos has become number one. Okay. That does not make any difference to them. End of the day, they're all billionaires. But the point is that indicates something. That indicates a huge increase in e-commerce and new financial instruments are emerging in the developed capital markets of the world. Of course, India also follows some of them, if not all of them. And the emphasis is increasing on the corporate social responsibility also throughout the world. And a lot of developments are happening in the field of information technology also. And most important of all of them is, these are all global trends. It's not that they are happening only in India or somewhere else they are not happening. Everywhere else, this is the same trend. So are we going to equip ourselves to be ready for the entire global requirements? Or are we going to restrict ourselves to our Companies Act 1956 or 2003, Income Tax Act 1961? Yes, we need them. We need them. But are we going to restrict ourselves there only? Is the point. We cannot. We cannot afford to do that. The Chartered Accountancy course is designed in such a way where the same qualified person can become an auditor also, a tax practitioner also, a consultant also, a management consultant also, financial advisor also, financial analyst also, internal auditor also, and even not a full-fledged economist, but an economic advisor for sure. So the point is, the scope of our profession or this course is not just restricted to India. It's an international course. And as you can see, some of the qualifications that I have earned or acquired, actually learned from those great institutions of all over the world. But one point why I'm bringing that here is, if there is any international course which is truly international, completely in terms of comprehensive coverage of any finance professional required in the current modern world economy, that is Indian Chartered Accountancy. I'm telling this not just because I'm a chartered accountant. I'm also a chartered management accountant. I'm also a certified management accountant, certified internal auditor, and a cost accountant from India also. I'm a chartered global management accountant also. But the point is, yes, those are all fantastic courses. A lot of knowledge is there into specialization, particularly. But which is the course which has the most comprehensive coverage of all the aspects of a finance division in an organization, that I can tell with confidence, that is only Chartered Accountancy, Indian Chartered Accountancy. That is why I call this as an international course. A lot of times CA students ask me, sir, along with CA, what international courses I should do? Because you also have a lot of international degrees. I will also try to do some international courses. They ask me. I say, you are already doing one. You are already studying an international course only, Baba. Who said you are studying an Indian course just because it is Institute of Chartered Accountants of India? Yes, it is established in India. We are going to be the products of Indian Institute, no doubt. But we are going to be there throughout the world, and we are already there throughout the world. Entire world has Indian Chartered Accountants at top of the positions in many major multinational organizations throughout the world. So we made our mark already, and we will continue to make our mark in the world of finance on the entire planet Earth. That is the level of course we are talking about Chartered Accountancy is. So other courses, international courses, they give us specialized knowledge into certain areas of our interest. That is purely a personal interest. But that is not just purely for career. One international course which opens up enormous opportunities into many fields is Indian Chartered Accountancy. And that is why we have to be equipping ourselves with the value-adding phenomenons also. For that purpose, we need a conceptual backbone. Economics is not going to directly give any kind of straightforward benefit visibly in our practice or employment in future. I know that. But it will act like a backbone. We may not see that. It will be helpful for us in doing so. A person who doesn't know many dynamics of business and the complexities of business dynamics, how can you prepare a feasibility study report of a big organization? They cannot. How can they prepare a project report? How can they forecast the profits or sales or financial numbers related to any organization for the future? Without knowing anything about the economy, without knowing things about basic things about how the businesses and economies work, how can anybody do that? Nobody can do that. If they do that, that will be a not so quality work. So the point once again I want to make here is the role of the chartered accountant is changing very drastically. Of course, this was all there in the introductory part of ICA material itself. Most of the times we just leave it. That is wrong. We should understand why are we studying one subject. The role of chartered accountant is changing, and these are the reasons for that change. And those factors definitely necessitate an increase in the competence of chartered accountants to take up the role of not merely an accountant or auditor. They are popularly called accountants and auditors, no doubt, but also a global solution provider. So solution provider course, there is no course like that. Okay, something called maybe I'll do this course and become a solution provider. No, sir. Unfortunately, there is no such course called solution provider course. But there is a role that has to be played by the finance professionals in the organizations also and outside the organizations also as consultants. That is required in the current scenario of finance profession in general. Chartered accountants in particular, we can say that is a shift that has happened from just being called as accountants or auditors. We are expected to be global solution providers. That will not happen by just learning some economics or by just learning some strategic management or by learning some EAS or by learning some financial management alone. All of them cumulatively in aggregate will help us in becoming one. That is the point. You cannot map input and output directly. So this course, chartered accountancy, is not carrot juice. It is not orange juice. Neither it is cucumber juice, nor it is any other pineapple juice. It is a mixed fruit juice. All of them, different fields of subjects put together only will be in the juicer, and finally the output that emerges is definitely going to be more healthy than one single juice or specialized juice. But it's a different story. I'm not telling orange juice itself is bad. It is also good. Some people like that, no problem. Some people may like carrot juice, no problem. That's good. There are courses for that. Internationally, the juices are generally specialized juices. But here, Indian context, chartered accountancy has been made in such a way that we have a mixed fruit juice. That is an advantage of it. That is a fantastic privilege that this course actually carries. And that keeps the chartered accountant's careers in safe hands. Because depending upon the requirements of the situations in the market demand, we can mold ourselves into that particular role. That role at a broader level in the world today is looked at as the global solution provider. And this subject or paper, EFF, we are going to call it Economics for Finance. It is also definitely dynamic, though we are not going to look at very recent developments of this. But still, the subject itself is very dynamic and interesting if we understand it in a proper way. So the economic variables always will be dynamic. They will not be static. And they keep on changing in real life. Subject will not change. The variables will keep on changing. And their influence on the decision making also will be very heavy, which necessitates once again a comprehensive understanding of the behavioral patterns of economic entities. Don't need to by heart or remember particularly any of these things, but understand the importance of EFF from ICAI's words. First of all, these variables are all dynamic and they will influence decision making. Because of that, every finance professional is definitely supposed to understand behavioral patterns of economic entities. And therefore, the tools of economics definitely have gained wider application in nearly all the areas of business and finance. So, tools of economics have emerged to be very important and inseparable portion of business and finance learning also, we can say. And that is the reason, once again, it has become important that our finance and accounting professionals, like chartered accountants, should be equipped with practical knowledge of the institutional framework and analytical tools of economics. So, in a nutshell, this can be considered as the reason for introduction of this subject for chartered accountancy students who are part of the finance and accounting students, global fraternity of finance and accounting students, include us also, include you also. But all of them require this understanding of economic tools and analytical tools, and they should have the understanding and knowledge of institutional framework of economics. What is this economics all about? At least at a broader level, we should know. But let me also warn you not to be thinking that by learning this subject or this paper, EFF, we are going to become economists. No. Economist is a big role or big word or to describe any person's profile. Of course, some people are called economists by media, including me. But I don't personally feel that I can be called as an economist, because the real research in the economics, in the field of economics, is done by purely that stream of students. There is a separate faculty of economics into the university degrees, BA economics, MA economics, MPhil, PhD. Oh, so many things are there. Econometrics is there. So different types of research activities happen in that field of economics. That is a much broader area and subject. So, we are not going to become economists, definitely, by looking at or understanding this subject. But of course, yes, we can understand what economists are going to speak. If an economist comes to a TV interview and says something about the economy, at least we should be able to understand, no? That much capacity finance professionals should have. Ideally, actually, students of finance also should have. For that purpose also, learning this subject will be important and interesting also, because it has a lot of practical application in real life, which we can see, but not like physically, but at least in newspapers you can see that. But that is where, once again, we have to keep our boundaries fixed. Otherwise, what happens? We will be just floating in the sea or ocean of economics without reaching our destination. That will be dangerous. That is why we have to have our boundaries fixed. We are going to jump into a swimming pool of economics. Of course, we are going to learn swimming, no doubt in that. But where we are learning, that we should be clear. We are learning in a swimming pool, not in an ocean, not in a river. There is a lot of water outside swimming pool. That is the real field of economics that happens outside chartered accountancy course also. That is not our scope. Our scope is to learn swimming within these four walls of swimming pool. And who prescribed these four walls? ICAI prescribed it. According to that only we have to learn. But is this only economics? No. There is much more economics beyond this. But learning that or understanding that will be of personal choice, not related to any course. But this subject we are going to learn now, this paper, Economics for Finance, is in accordance with what has been prescribed by ICAI. And as you are already aware, in general, the economics subject can be broadly classified into microeconomics and macroeconomics. And rightly so, ICAI has done and kept this microeconomics at the foundation level and macroeconomics at the interlevel. That is not what we are going to study now as part of economics for finance. That name is just something, but what basically it is some of the aspects of macroeconomics. Always that we have to keep in mind. Oh, entire economics is micro and macro and both are covered by CA course. Enough, no? We know economics. Like that some people think. Unfortunately, that is not true. Microeconomics in foundation was definitely covering some of the aspects of microeconomics. Yes, important aspects of microeconomics. Yes, no doubt. For general purpose understanding, it is enough. That's what ICAI has introduced them at that level. And what we are going to learn now as part of EFF paper is some of the aspects of macroeconomics and broader principles of macroeconomics, broader concepts of macroeconomic indicators and macroeconomic policies. That's only is going to be the syllabus or part of the contents of this paper EFF, which is broadly the macroeconomics. So yes, some portion of microeconomics, some portion of macroeconomics has been covered in the chartered accountancy course, which is fantastic, which is very important, required. So it is not just a personal interest with which a candidate has to learn economics, but it is now requirement as part of the syllabus also to learn economics, which is very important in real life. But once again, we may not be able to see that tangibly by matching one to one. Like we cannot match the importance of A plus B whole square in our life. We cannot explain that. But it is there somewhere. In every device that we are using, maybe it is there. Somewhere in the program, it might be there. We don't know that. It is not tangible to us. So usefulness may not be tangible, but definitely it is useful. Same way, economics as a subject also is very useful for finance professionals, as we have just now understood. That is the reason, purpose of introducing these two things at different levels. And naturally, at foundation level, microeconomics was more focused, and at intermediate level, as a part of EFF paper, macroeconomic principles have been introduced. Just for general understanding, what are the things that will be contained in microeconomics? Most of them are there in foundation already. If you have already studied it, fine, that's good. Mainly, what are the aspects will be there in microeconomics? Product pricing, consumer behavior, factor pricing, economic conditions of a section of people, not the entire economy. Particular individuals or households or businesses, entities, that is micro. Behavior of the firms, once again, not the entire economy. Location of the industry. These are all some of the aspects covered in microeconomics. So to put in a nutshell, rather than going through many items, simply speaking, microeconomics is all about two people, naturally. One is consumers, other one is suppliers. That's all. And when we talk about consumers, we should know the behavior of the consumers. And we should know the theory of demand, which is the consumer's side of the story. And when you talk about the suppliers, we should know the theory of production and theory of cost and the theory of supply itself. That is all from the supplier side. In any bigger economy also, if you just segment people into two categories, what two categories will be there? Only two categories will be there. Only two. There will be consumers, there will be suppliers. Always. So microeconomics tells us about what is the theory of demand, what is the behavior of the consumers, etc. That is one portion of it. Second portion of it is theory of supply, theory of production and theory of cost. All of them are from the point of view of suppliers. That's all. Both aspects are covered in the microeconomics. That is part of CA Foundation syllabus. Most of the syllabus of CA Foundation. But that was all mostly microeconomics applied and called as business economics in foundation level. What are the things that are generally covered in macroeconomics? National income and national output. Are we going to cover it here as part of EFF? Answer is yes. General price levels and interest rates. Interest rates, are we going to cover? Definitely yes. Balance of trade, balance of payments, international trade. Are we going to cover? Yes. External value of the currency. What is currency? What is money, first of all? And why there will be difference in the exchange rates of currency of one country to another country? Are we going to learn all of that as part of macroeconomics? Yes. And other factual things. Factual things are statistical things. Overall levels of savings and investment, what they are happening. There is nothing to learn in that. That is a reality. If it is there, whatever is there, that will be a statistical thing, factual thing. Same way, the level of unemployment or employment and the rate of economic growth, that is a factual thing. See, macroeconomics, that is why, has multiple things here we have to understand. At a broader level, we have to look at it into two areas. One is the conceptual things, the second one is the statistical things. If I say GDP of India is expected to be growing by 6%, if I tell and give a statement like that, that is a factual thing or a statistical thing, because I'm talking about a forecast. You cannot say fact, but it is definitely a statistical thing. But how the GDP is first of all computed, how the growth rates of GDP are calculated, what is GDP, why GDP, why are we even talking about this, that is conceptual. So macroeconomics always has both the aspects. One is conceptual, second one is statistical. Microeconomics had consumer, supplier. Macroeconomics has conceptual, statistical understanding. The second part is something like a information part. It is not knowledge. If somebody asks how much billions of dollars of foreign reserves are there with India as of today, I don't know. I don't need to know. I can Google it. If it is there, whatever the number comes, that is a reality. That is a statistical thing. That is the difference between data, information, and knowledge. That is just data, actually. Information is a little bit processed data. Let us say how the foreign reserves of India have been changing from the past 10 years. Put them on a graph. That can be also a statistical thing. But at least that gives some kind of a visual understanding of, okay, whether the foreign reserves of India, foreign currency reserves of India, dollar reserves particularly, are they increasing or decreasing? Oh yes, definitely they are increasing. Fantastically, they are increasing over the past 10 years. That conclusion we can draw if at all we look at that graph. These are examples. But that is also not knowledge. That is information. Knowledge is what? First of all, what is currency? What is foreign currency? Why there should be foreign currency reserves? Is it good to have too much of foreign currency reserves or bad to have? What factors will help in increasing the foreign currency reserves and what factors will help in diminishing or diluting the foreign currency reserves? That is knowledge. That is the difference we have to understand. And what are we going to learn here in this subject? Boss, this is not the one what we are going to learn. The statistical things is not our area of interest. Our area of interest is conceptual macroeconomics, not the statistical macroeconomics, which is a very fantastic move taken by ICAI after, in the earlier regime of CPT type of examinations, they used to have microeconomics, macroeconomics, two portions within the same paper of economics. And in that, a dump of data they used to give, a growth rate, agriculture rate, that, this. So many things, all just data, and people have to buy heart to them. What is the use? what is the capital of a particular country? Let us say, if I ask you, what is the capital of Zimbabwe? Most of the people might not know. Okay, let us say if some of you know that. So what great thing you have achieved? In my view, nothing. It's good. I appreciate. You know that. I appreciate. That's all. But nothing great in that. You can just Google it. Anybody can just know that. That is not knowledge. So earlier, CPT regime had this completely nonsensical, in my view, portion of macroeconomics, which fortunately and very well removed by ICAI from the CPT, and now foundation has only microeconomics, which are scientific, which are theoretical, conceptual, and mostly we can say textbook type approaches. Various theories of economics, microeconomic theories, were introduced in foundation level. When they said macroeconomics is going to be shifted to CA intermediate, I was afraid. Are they going to put the entire same thing as macroeconomics here also, a dump of data where the students have to by heart it and vomit it in the exam? And fortunately and very well thought of decision by ICAI was, no, that dump of data, entire macroeconomics is gone. Now they have introduced a conceptual macroeconomics. That is economics for finance. Whether we know the data related to macroeconomics or not, that we can know with the click of a button, that anybody can know with the current technology, that is not a big deal about it. But do we have the ability to interpret it? Do we have the ability to understand it? Do we have the ability to analyze it? That will not come with the click of a button. That comes with knowledge. That comes with subject learning. And that comes with, of course, experience also over a period of time. For that purpose, this entire macroeconomics or economics for finance has been introduced by ICAI, and it is the one of the best moves done in the syllabus change, we can say. Removing that macroeconomic data dump and introducing economics for finance at CA intermediate level is a fantastic introduction. And it is very helpful for chartered accountancy students when they become finance professionals in a full-fledged manner. So that is the background of micro and macro economics as part of the syllabus. And I think long back, even before even we qualified as chartered accountants, maybe our previous generations had this economics syllabus in their final. Somebody was telling me. They used to have, one of the senior chartered accountants was telling me, they had economics in final those days. Final. From final, where we have moved over a period of time to foundation and inter. And that too in a very well-designed manner. So excellent division of micro and macroeconomics in the syllabus of ICAI. Completely appreciate that. But yes, these are the two things that microeconomics and macroeconomics cover. To put it in summarized manner, microeconomics talks about consumers and suppliers. Macroeconomics is conceptual and statistical, but we will only focus on conceptual aspects of macroeconomics. That's what is included in economics for finance paper. What are the contents of this? Broadly, it has four categorizations and naturally four chapters. One of the things is basic economic indicators, like national income computation and all. Those are macroeconomic principles, subject matters of macroeconomics. Public finance, a very important aspect. Monetary theories and international economics. These are the four things that this paper or subject of economics for finance will cover. And those are naturally divided into different chapters. First chapter here is determination of national income, like very popular measure. If you open the newspaper, any channel, anywhere, somewhere, any panel discussion of economists or intellectuals or so-called people like that, they'll always talk about GDP and all. That is one kind of an economic aggregate, entire macroeconomic aggregate. Like that, there will be numerous macroeconomic aggregates, One of the types of that is GDP, which is more popular, so we use that. But that is not the only one. But in this chapter, what are the macroeconomic aggregates, first of all, possible to be evaluated? What is the meaning of them? What is the nature of them? And not only just nature, measurement of national income also we have to do. So are we going to conduct a survey of the entire country and get information from the people? We cannot do that. So that will be given to us. After all that we are going to do is use some formulae and concepts of how to calculate this national income. That is one of the important aspects in this entire paper. And not only the theoretical questions, even problems can be expected from that. Usually 5 marks problem is quite common from that area of measurement of national income. Measurement includes certain numerical questions. Only that portion of this chapter or unit will have it. And GDP is only one of the national macro level economic aggregates. There will be so many things like that. What are those things that we will learn as part of unit 1 of chapter 1. Unit 2 of chapter 1 is once again purely theoretical, conceptual, not much of application directly we can do, but yes, conceptual level analysis understanding we can do. That is Keynes theory, called Keynesian theory of determination of national income. So Keynesian theory of how to determine national income will be discussed in unit 2 of chapter 1. Then chapter 2 consists of public finance. That is the name of the chapter. What it will contain is 4 subunits. Unit 1 tells us about what are the fiscal functions in general. See, public finance means public finance, people think finance taken by public. No, we need to understand certain points here. Words are used in different contexts, in different meanings. Public here means government. Public finance means here government. Fiscal policy means government's policy. So here public means state or government. We'll come to that. What is one of the functions of the government, particularly state government in Indian context? Sorry, central government in Indian context. Central governments will have fiscal functions. What are those? That is a general understanding. In fact, that will be repeated in chapter 3 or unit 3 also. 3 and 4 will have first one only repeated. So first unit of chapter 2, we cannot actually say much speciality is there. It is actually a summary of all the other 3, particularly the last 2. But that will be introduced here in the unit 1. Then market failure is a very important conceptual aspect. We always say that market is king, market is supreme. Yes, it is. But will it not fail? It will fail. And why it will fail? Why it might fail? What could be the possible reasons for such market failure? That will be discussed in this chapter. And when the market fails, what government should do? Should it just watch and enjoy that failure? No. It has to intervene to correct the market failure. Market might fail for different reasons. Whatever the reasons may be, it is the government's responsibility to intervene into the market failure and correct it. Why is that? How the government will intervene? Those things will be discussed in unit 3 of chapter 2. And fiscal policy of the government. And once again, fiscal policy means we are talking about central government. Normally, the subject, in this subject of economics, that is macroeconomics, that is economics for finance, we are talking about country as a whole. Whenever we are referring to an economy, we are not talking about a city's economy, we are not talking about a district's economy or a state's economy, we are talking about the country's economy as a whole. Naturally, for us, country means India. But when the reference is given, then entire world economy also we can talk about. Outside India, whatever is there, that is the remaining world other than us. So it is that level of subject. We are not talking about smaller things. We are talking about aggregate things. So that is why sometimes macroeconomics is also called as aggregate economics, and bigger things like entire country, sometimes entire world, rarely though. But in general, whenever we use the word economy, we are talking about country. So naturally, whenever we use the word government, which government we are talking? Naturally, central government. That is Indian Union's central government. Unless otherwise stated, government means that. Of course, if there is any specific reference required for state level, that will be made, but that will be rare. In general, whenever we say government intervention, in general, it will be of the central government. In general. How the governments are structured, how the social structure of politics is designed, that is a completely different topic altogether. And when we are to understand also another point, that this subject what we are learning, though we have to apply it and we have to understand it from Indian context, this subject is not Indian subject only, no? Fiscal functions American government will not have, or what? Every government will have. Okay, other countries market failures will not happen, or what? Every market might fail. Other countries will government intervene? Yes, everywhere it will happen. So this is international subject. That is a point we have to keep in mind. Anybody in the world actually can understand the same subject. Anybody. Because this is the essence of macroeconomic principles. And role of government in general in the economy is what is public finance all about. In that, what is the major policy that any government takes is called as fiscal policy. That is part of chapter 2. Then chapter 3 is about money markets. Money markets is another topic. And here, what is the concept of money? First of all, what is money? We just use this word very loosely. What is money? Why money is required? Those core things we will enter into and understand them in this unit 1 of chapter 3. And what is the concept of money demand and money supply? Both of them will be understood in chapter 3, unit 1 and 2. And just like fiscal policy, which is taken by central government, monetary policy in India, which is taken by Reserve Bank of India. What is monetary policy and what kind of monetary policy decisions that Reserve Bank of India will take can be discussed in chapter 3, unit 3. But once again, most of the conceptual things are international in nature. Very particular things like certain words and certain policy names are purely Indian. Other than that, every country will have money. Every country will have money demand and money supply. The concepts are same. And every country will have its own reserve bank. That can be called by different names. In some other country, it may be called as central bank. In some other countries, it may be called federal bank, like America. In USA, United States of America, it's called Fed, which is nothing but Federal Reserve. So it's called Federal Reserve or Fed, simply. In some other countries, it is called Central Bank. For example, in the country where I worked earlier, in Bahrain, that is called Central Bank of Bahrain, CBB. They have their own monetary policy and various types of decisions that they will take. That is a regulatory body also. Same with India, Reserve Bank of India, we call it. So, names differ. Roles are more or less the same. More or less the same. That is, once again, we have to understand. Concepts of all these macroeconomic things are similar. Concepts are international. Application may not be always the same throughout the world. Of course, that has to be a little bit of customization done according to the requirements of that country. But what is monetary policy? What is the role of a central bank of a country? That is same. But how the central bank will actually take the policy, that might differ. And what is the structure of that particular organization? That might differ. Who will elect the members of them or board of directors of them? That might differ. But we are not worried about them. When it comes to those things, we only look at Indian context. But when it comes to the conceptual things, we are discussing international things that we have to understand and keep in mind. Then the fourth chapter here in this paper is international trade. So this is all about, name itself indicates, international. There are various theories of international trade. What are those? We have to understand them. What are the various aspects and instruments of trade policy? Trade policy means here not internal trade, we are talking international trade. How the trade negotiations will happen. so many organizations are there in the world where the negotiations will happen, trade negotiations. And what happened and history of that trade negotiations will be discussed in chapter 4. And very importantly, the exchange rates and the economic effects of that. One of the important units of this chapter, exchange rates, foreign exchange rates. How do they fluctuate, or what do they represent? What is the impact of them? Once again, we are not bothered about today, what is the India-US dollar exchange rate? That is information. But what factors might impact the exchange rate of US dollar and Indian rupee? That is conceptual. So we are going to understand those conceptual aspects of exchange rates and the economic effects of exchange rates. And in general, what international capital movements, FDI, FPI, like that, what are those things, will be discussed in chapter 4, unit 5. So chapter 4 is completely dedicated to international aspects, international trade, mostly generic in nature, nothing much technical except first and fourth units. Most of the other things in the chapter 4 are generic in nature, general knowledge types, social studies types. But yes, other things, all the aspects ranging from first chapter, second chapter, third chapter are not just generic things. They are technical things, they are conceptual things, and they have to be understood from the world-renowned theories made by renowned economists already in the world. So that is the syllabus of this paper subject, Economics for Finance, which contributes 40 marks to paper 8 of group 2 of CA Intermediate. And what are the key features of this paper? Examination point of view, let us see. Very important feature here is the number of marks awarded to each question is very small. Questions of 2 marks, 3 marks will be asked most. 5 marks questions are also rare. Actually, 2 marks, 3 marks, 2 marks, 3 marks are the type of questions. Usually, a question will be having 10 marks, which will usually have 3 or 4 subsegments. Let us say one will have 2, other will have 3, 3, 2, 10 marks over. Like that, another question will have 10 marks. It will have 3 shell segments maybe. One is 2, one is 3, or one is 5, like that. 5 marks questions also, more than one we cannot expect. Mostly one question will come, maximum 2 will come, 5 marks questions. So in general, if you see, most of the questions are either 2 or 3 marks questions here. That is the very important, strikingly different feature of this paper when compared with any other paper. Even in the paper like law also, auditing also, 4 marks questions are quite common. So rarely 6 and 8 marks questions also will come. A combination of them will come. But this paper, this particular Economics for Finance portion, will have very smaller questions. So what is the good news in that? What is the bad news in that? Good news is, you don't have to write 2 big answers. You don't have to fill the papers. You don't have to answer in a very elaborate manner. You can just summarize your answers. In other words, your understanding is tested here, not your entire memory of certain points. No, memory is required. Of course, yes. But what is tested is not just the memory. If a bigger question is asked, let us say, for example, something like, what are the advantages and disadvantages of foreign direct investment? If that question is asked, it will become an essay question. It will become actually a 20 marks question, if at all it is asked. And no such questions can be expected. That's a social studies question. What are all the positive points of foreign trade in foreign direct investment? What are all the negative points of foreign direct investment? FDI is good or bad? What is your opinion? Those questions are all definitely bigger questions. Such questions are not asked here. That is the good news. Though we need to know them in conceptual level, but such questions are not asked, which are big questions. So questions are always smaller, which means while learning this subject itself, we can understand how much to be written for a certain question. 2-3 marks question, how many lines you will write? Maximum 8 lines, 7 lines. Somewhere between 5-8 lines, we can say. Somewhere between 5-8 lines. Of course, that changes from student to student depending upon handwriting, but in general I am telling about 5 to 8 lines of answer is more than enough. Somewhere in between 5 lines, 6 lines also is enough for 2-3 marks question. What will you write more than that? If there are points in that your answer, it's the same, like somewhere around 4 to 8 or 6 points you can write. If it is points, double the number of marks. If it is number of lines as a paragraph, it is 2.5 times the number of marks. I mean, there is no rule like that. And don't think that by writing something using this weighing mechanism, you will get marks. No, that is minimum, we can say. That is minimum requirement. So you don't need to write long answers and too many points. Core points, crux of the concept, can be just expressed. And that is why if you understand this subject well, you can score well. That automatically brings to this feature. That becomes scoring. How it becomes scoring? By understanding it well and having the ability to express ourselves in a concise, precise manner, straight to the question, and giving what exactly is asked in the question, the concept of it. No need to elaborate it, no need to write any stories around it. That will fetch better marks with the right approach, of course. And as we understood already with the previous slides discussion, this subject is conceptual, not statistical, not purely some data-based remembrance. It is a conceptual subject. In other words, you understand something, that's it. You understand it for life. It is not something like memorizing type of subject. Memory is still required. This is the problem. When we say it is more conceptual, that does not mean less memory is required or no memory is required. Memory is required. But compared to, let us say, subjects like taxation, you need to remember so many provisions for taxation, for example. Lot of memory will be required in that subject. Concept is very less percentage in that. That too, if we understand the intent of the statute. Otherwise, it is mostly memory based and application of that provision in a particular problem. But this subject is not like that. This is a conceptual subject. And since the questions are also smaller, you don't need to by heart huge sentences. Don't ever by heart sentences or paragraphs. That is a mistake people try to do, and they will not succeed also. It is not easy to by heart or remember sentences and paragraphs. Don't try to do that. You read sentences and paragraphs. That is for reading, not for remembering. What has to be remembered? Points. Only key points, core conceptual points have to be remembered. So those points are key areas and terms. So two things here. One is points, one is terms. Terms means, I mean to say, vocabulary, the words used. You use better words, you get better marks. Simple logic. Message can be conveyed in two ways. With good words or with bad words or not so good words. Ultimately, what you mean is same. Nobody is saying that you don't understand it. But it is quite common, right? When you read something with better vocabulary, you will be more impressed. So naturally, when you use the terminology correctly, then only you will gain good marks. That is the basic reality of any theory paper in chartered accountancy. And naturally that applies to EFF paper also. Terminology is key. Lot of times people use hearsay terminology. Whatever they listened in the class, whatever they understood and actually kept in their brain. Understanding is there, but unfortunately they cannot express. If you cannot express your understanding, that is definitely not going to give us marks. To obtain marks, more score, you need to be able to express your understanding. Understanding is one part. Expressing that understanding on paper with better terminology is another part. That is also required here, and that requires conceptual clarity. More clarity you have, easy it becomes to express. Less clarity you have, more by-hearting you have to do, and naturally that will cause certain problems in the examination. Not required. So simply, this paper or subject has to be understood and remembered point-wise, and key terms have definitely to be remembered. And as we can see in the upcoming classes, definitely it is an interesting subject because of various reasons. One most important reason is it is practical, in the sense it has real life application, what we can daily now see. If you are learning, all the subjects that you are learning have practical applications, by the way. Everything has practical application. Whatever you are learning, income tax or financial management or costing or accounts, everything is useful in real life, no doubt about it, auditing, etc. But you cannot see that now. You cannot actually see the application now. In order to really apply the financial management and strategic financial management principles, it will take at least 10 years from now onwards for you to really apply it in the real life. Why? Because you need to first of all reach to that position, a strategic position, like manager, senior manager, CFO. That will take time. That will take a lot of time. So the point is, application of what you are learning now in the course, that will take time. It will happen eventually, but not immediately. But the advantage of economics and what makes it interesting is, this you can do daily. If you now you know GDP, okay, next day morning if some newspaper talks about GDP, you already know that. Oh, this is GDP. Oh, this is GNP. Oh, this is foreign currency. Oh, this is what is happening in economy. Somebody talks about fiscal policy. You know what is fiscal policy? You can see all these things in daily life. You don't need to wait for career, because these principles of economics that we are learning, though we call it economics for finance, this is economics for life. This is economics for any citizen who should know, ideally. But unfortunately, we cannot expect everybody to know. At least we should know. As professional course students, we should know them, and application of them we can observe many places in real life. So that is why it will in general be interesting also. But other side of it also is there. Some people tend to apply too much. There is always a balance that is required. That is called a trade-off. Trade-off is one of the important things. Balance. Should we blindly by heart to this subject? That is one category, one extreme people. Useless. No use. Even if you get 40 out of 40 also, I will not respect you. Why? Because useless. Blindly by hearting something and wanting in the examination and getting high marks and ranks is not what this course is required and made of. That is useless. But other side of the people, each and every word, each and every line, they want to know. Why there is comma there, why there is full stop there. That is another extreme. Every word. Curiosity is good. Curiosity is good to be a feature. But unfortunately, what happens? If that much level of curiosity is there with us, then we should be ready to pursue this chartered accountancy course also in learning process for that much longer time. And let me very clearly tell you, this subject or paper of economics for finance, content wise, I can teach for say around 200 hours also easily. That much content is there, because a lot of explanation can be given. So much of things can be understood. This subject itself is too beautiful. Entire year I can teach you economics for finance. But are you ready for that? Is that our purpose? No. That is where balance has to be made. You should not be too entering into the real life. We have to also keep our limitations in mind. End of the day, we are looking at theoretical aspects, which are mostly conceptual in nature, which have some practical application. That's all. Not that every line I will apply practically, every line I want to see what happens in real life. That is difficult. That is not possible, and that is not feasible, not required also. So that is where the point is. We have to balance. Blind by hearting is useless. Research in economics is also useless. If we are really interested in doing research in economics, we should not be in chartered accountancy. We should go to any other course like BA economics, MA economics, then MPhil, PhD. There is a separate stream for it. Then fantastic research we can do in the subject of economics. That is different and very good. I'm completely having a lot of respect for that stream of students. If that is our interest, then we have to go there, not in CA. We cannot do research here. We are not economists. We don't have that much of knowledge like really the economists have. And people claim that. That's okay. People claim a lot of things what they are not. But we don't have to be lying to ourselves. We are going to learn the outline of macroeconomics, understanding of basic things related to macroeconomic principles and concepts. That's all. In that, we'll try to make it interesting in a way. To the extent possible, we can understand the real life application of it. Once again, to the extent possible only. That is why we need to make a clear trade-off between purely looking at it from examination point of view or purely looking at it from real life point of view. Somewhere in between our approach has to be, which is naturally the trade-off between both the aspects. Then definitely this learning process will be very interesting, and scoring also. That is why both are to be kept intact. We have to make it scoring and we have to also keep it interesting. And what are the things we need to do for learning this subject and scoring better? What are the do's? What are the things that we are supposed to do, we can say? What are those? One is reading. This is one thing where I have a lot of complaints on many students. Nowadays, students are not reading. Very dangerous. Because various reasons, I'm not completely blaming the students. But ultimately, who will suffer is you only, no? Who will suffer is students only. That is why we cannot make excuses of external realities. We have to understand reading is very important in any subject, particularly for theory subjects. And when we are talking about EFF, definitely reading is very, very, very important. Reading habit is important. A lot of students nowadays have lost the habit of reading. They are more interested in watching, viewing, listening, because we became spectators. That is not going to help. We have to learn from somebody, like you are trying to learn from me now. That's okay, but that is not ultimate. That is not the end of learning. That is the beginning of learning. And a lot of people think that that is the end of learning. Oh, I attended this classes, I attended that classes. Oh, that class is complete, this class is complete, this syllabus is complete. What is the use? You are supposed to do the effort of all these things. One of the most important things is reading. You can't read now. What can we read in future? Maybe in future you have to read hundreds of pages of say some project report of a company. If you don't read, you don't develop the habit of reading now, what kind of a better chartered accountant we can become? I know a lot of chartered accountants who really don't read properly. They read so quickly and just like that they will ignore certain key points in some of the important agreements and legal deeds also. And will it not cost them their profession? Yes, definitely. That is wrong. And why they have become like that? Because at student level, they were not good in reading. Nobody told them, or maybe they did not follow. Somebody told them also. So I request you to please follow these steps very clearly. Reading is very important. Reading does not mean, once again, research. Each and every line, oh, going into the depth of it, not necessarily. General reading is also enough. But while reading, we have to have what in mind? Are we understanding or not? While reading, are we understanding or not is important. Not a blind reading or blind by heart. Of course, understanding will also happen in classes. When you watch and listen to these classes, definitely your understanding of what you read will develop. This purpose of the classes is only that. Not that automatically economics is infused into your brains. This is one kind of strange expectation or some false promises also from the teaching community and learning community, that people are expecting subjects to be inserted into their brains. Because that is not possible medically, practically, technically, pedagogically, anyway, it is not possible. What a teacher can do is improve your ability of understanding. Understanding, who has to do? You have to do only. So while attending these classes going forward, while listening to and watching and understanding these classes, it will definitely enhance your ability of understanding what you are going to read in this subject. Okay, you understood. Then what? Enough? Great job? Yes, it is great job. But is it enough? No. You have to write. Write what? You have to write the same things as I told already. You have to write the summary. In other words, either you have to write the points, key points, and most importantly, the key terminology. So terminology and points have to be written by you. And good news in this paper is you don't have to write big answers also. One question, tuck, 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 4 points, enough. Another question, tuck, 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 5, 6 points are there, enough. That's it. So simple notes you have to prepare, your own notes you have to prepare, then you will succeed in theory papers. That is another unfortunate trend or whatever expectation. Students think that notes given by some other chartered accountant or a faculty member, faculty, teacher, will be used by them by just looking at it and trying to vomit in the examination. That will not actually effectively help you in recollecting also, remembering also. That is not a scientific way of learning also. So what is the best way of learning any theoretical subject? And not only EFF, I'm telling, this applies to any subject, theoretical in the sense I'm talking about text-based subjects, not numerical subjects. Including in the group 1, law, taxation. In the group 2, auditing, EFF, strategic management, EIS. For all of them, one common point is you have to write. You have to write your own notes. Your own notes, not somebody else's given notes. Printed, watching on mobile phone, that is all okay. But after that also, you should have your own notes in your handwriting. Why is that? That helps you remember easily. Nobody in the world can remember anything better than his own or her own handwriting. That is a scientifically proven fact. Your handwriting, you will remember because you wrote, no? While writing also, one stroke of memory has happened in your brain. Well, after revising it also, you have another stroke of memory has happened. So your brain has registered that while writing. And that makes you remember it easily. That does not mean when you write automatically, you will remember. After that, you have to do revisions. That's fine. But it makes it much easier to remember when you write with your own handwriting and remember those points and terminology also related to each of these concepts. And of course, in the examination, you have to recollect them. Whatever you remembered, what is the use of that if you cannot retrieve it? If you cannot retrieve it, what is the use? I have a lot of memory, but my hard disk is corrupt. What is the use of it? So you have to be able to recollect it. And how that will come? You have to test your results occasionally. Certain points. Okay, some questions you just open randomly and check that whether your memory is properly working or not. Are you able to recollect or not? Like that, you have to give your brain some exercises of memory, not any techniques, any medicines or any other things will help to improve your memory. Memory is of course possible to be improved in many ways also. Though those are called scientific, they are not going to be helpful in learning process of a subject. Learning process of a subject has to be in an understanding manner, not purely memorizing and reproducing. No. That is why all these steps have to be followed one after the other carefully, and once these are all followed, then naturally better score can be achieved from this paper. And for that matter, this entire stepwise approach of what approach has to be followed is applicable for any theory subject. Read, understand, write, remember, recollect. These are the things to be done. Then what are the things not to be done? Particularly while learning this subject. These are not applicable for others, but generally because we don't have such type of limitations for other subjects. But this subject, economics for finance, has a peculiar nature. It has. We cannot help it. It has a peculiar nature. What is that? First and foremost thing is economics and politics are very closely interrelated with each other. So naturally, when we understand and read and try to appreciate or comprehend any principle of economics, naturally our brain will take it to some politics. Some politics, whatever it may be, it will take. I'm not telling it is bad or it should not happen. But what I'm telling is, control it. Don't take it too literally. These are human things. Everybody will have certain political thought or affiliation or inclination. Nothing wrong in that. Whatever that political thought may be, inclination might be, we are not here to discuss that. Some people might have a left inclination, some people might have a right inclination. Different economists themselves have different political and economic inclinations. And there is no dearth of alternatives here. So many types of schools of thought are there throughout the world. And all are great economists, no? See, Nobel Prize is given to so many economists so far, just for understanding purposes. Let us say some 40 Nobel laureates, if at all they are all alive. Some number of, say some 20, so definitely will be alive. 20 Nobel laureates who got Nobel Prize in economics, bring them and keep them in one room, give them some conference hall, and give them some food, and give them one day, full day. Let them discuss. Nobel laureates, no, they are all world's topmost economists, right? Give them one day, and or maybe give them 1 week also, no problem. Give them all food and everything, comforts they want. In a big five-star hotel, no problem. That much the world can afford. Let them come out with one best model for the entire world. Let them come out. What this world requires in the form of economy. How this world should be. Entire world, let us say, imaginarily agrees. Whatever these people finally conclude. 20 people. Whatever they say, entire world has agreed that they will follow them. Some people are thinking this is reality and all. This is imagination, Baba. Story this is. I'm talking about an example, imaginary story. If is the word used there. So you gave them 1 week and asked them, sir, what is the conclusion? I bet there will be no conclusion. Okay, give them 1 month. I bet there will be no conclusion. Give them their entire life. I bet there will be no conclusion. Because each of them will have their own opinion. Oh, each of them thinks they are top. Because they are top. They are all Nobel laureates. Each of them will have different opinions. And they will never come to one line of thought. Not possible. That much diversity is there. Natural, that is. Nothing wrong in that. So we should not get into and fall into those type of things. There will be diverse views. Let them be there. But they should not dominate our learning process. They should not dominate our learning process. So politics has to be kept aside. Fact, subject, context has to be understood as it is. So that's what I call it sometimes, as is. This is one important thing, useful in life also, and particularly in this subject, we have to get it as is. Our own political inclinations, our own prejudices, our own sentiments, our emotions, we will have all of them, but we should curtail them. We should keep them maybe in a locker for some time, because that is not our purpose here. So they have to be curtailed. They have to be at least for some time be controlled, we can say. Not completely. I'm not saying that you should never have emotions. I'm not saying that you should never have political inclinations or sentiments or prejudices. It is natural for human beings. I have. You will also have. Nothing wrong in that. But to the extent they hamper our learning process, that is not good for us. Why should we have them? Imagine, let us say, if one of the learners of economics says, this guy, say Karl Marx, the moment we take the name, already prejudice started in some people. Karl Marx, communist, we have some other names for it also. Bad things people have in mind, some people. And some people think he is saint or he is somebody who is beyond normal human beings' understanding. Both are two extremes. My point is, why should we have any of those feelings? If there is something that Karl Marx told, if there is something which is helpful for us, we will take it. If not, we will leave it. Why should we have some kind of emotion or sentiment or prejudice or political thought about this person? Or for that matter, any other person who might have told something which we may not like or we like. Both are possible. That is the point here we have to understand. Economics is very, very closely related to politics. And if we don't draw a line between them while understanding economics itself, then the learning process will be unnecessarily hampered. I'm not saying we cannot apply it later. Once we learn economics, you learn all types of economics, no problem. There are economists who are called demand-side economists, there are socialist economists, there are communist economists, there are pure capitalist economists or market economists, monetary economists are there, supply-side economists are there, welfare economists are there, recently getting more popular, welfare economists. For example, Abhijit Banerjee is popularly considered to be one of the welfare economists in the world. Different categories of people are there. We may like them, we may not like them, we may agree with them, we may not agree with them. That is different story. That should not come into our learning process. Our learning process has to be objective. It should not be with prejudice. It should not be with bias. It should not be with any kind of emotional, sentimental or political inclinations. Whether it is liking or disliking, both should be kept at abeyance. That is required for learning of this subject. Usually this requirement will not be there for any other subject in chartered accountancy. Why? Because those are all just facts. Income Tax Act is Income Tax Act. Whatever the particular section 32 of Income Tax Act says, okay, let us say you say, no, I disagree with that. What are you going to do? You can't do anything. It is there, it is there. So just have to learn the law, whatever it tells. Silently, we have to learn it and apply it. Same way with many other things also. But being a social science, economics is different. It has definitely close link with the politics. That is why actually in the world, it is called political economy. Economy itself is not existent. Politics is not existing without economy or economics. So political economy is the word used in the usual parlance throughout the world. Reason is, those are closely interrelated. So should we allow that interrelation? Should we allow that close association between economics and politics to hamper our learning of economics? My point is no. We can do that at a later stage. Once we get more matured, once we get more understanding of economics, we are just learning the basic aspects of basic macroeconomics. At this level, we jump to final conclusions on politics, we jump to conclusions or kind of prejudices we form about various theories that have been propagated by different economists in the world, I think that is too early for us. At this level, there is a lot of subject of economics. Even after that also, we don't need to have prejudices in the learning process. Application is different. And I am sure that application at a personal level will not be required for any of you. So simple point is, while learning this subject, learn it as is, without political thought or inclinations, without any sentiments, prejudices or emotions. That is the advice. But yes, I know that also, naturally, since we are human beings, these things will come, they will emerge. Suddenly they pop up. How can it be like that? How wrong it is? How good it is? How great it is? How worst it is? All things will come up. Bad things will come up, good things will come up, because society and economy are having all. In accounting, debit, credit, both are there. Can you say debit is better than credit or credit is better than debit? Is there anything like that? No, you cannot tell that because both are equal. But society is not like that, no? Economy is not like that, no? There will not be equals here. There will be inequals. Lot of things, bad things will be there. We have to just observe, understand them enough. What are we going to do about them? That you might do when you become older and older and when you become the citizens of this country with, of course, voting power and any other contribution that you can make to the economy in future. But at the learning level of economics, we don't have to get into those areas, is my suggestion. That is the don'ts, we can say. With that, we can conclude today's introductory session on economics for finance. And in the next session, we'll start with the chapter 1, unit 1 of this paper. Till then, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.